This is Sahithi on behalf of Edureka, and I welcome you to this session on UiPath Automation Examples. So guys, in this session, we'll be mainly focusing on UiPath and how you can automate different tasks using this particular tool. So now, without wasting any further time, let me take you to the topics for today's session. So in today's session, we'll start this session by understanding the very basic concept, that is, what is automation? And once you understand that, I'll give you a short introduction on what is UiPath. Once you understand both these terms, that is automation and UiPath, we'll get into the main topic, that is the different examples for automation, right? So first of all, we'll be looking into moving files from the source folder to the destination folder. And then I'll show you different kinds of automation, such as the web automation, email automation, Excel automation, and the PDF automation, right? So I hope the agenda is clear to you. All right, so let's get started, guys. So now let's start with the very basic concept, that is, what is automation? Now, to understand this concept, let's just consider a scenario where a person's sole job is to collect the data from multiple sources and then aggregate them into an Excel file. Now, do you think this person should do this job on a daily basis, or, you know, he can instead automate this task? Obviously, the second option sounds better, right? So if you just automate this task of, you know, aggregating the data from multiple sources and then putting them in an Excel file, what he can simply do is he can just make a robot do it for him. Right. So when I say a robot do it for him, what I mean is that when a robot does the automation from him, a robot will be designed to collect data from multiple sources and then store them in an Excel file. So obviously, with the help of this, the human intervention is reduced. This tedious task takes less amount of time, and also it's less error prone. Right. So this is what automation is, guys. So if I have to just define automation for you, then automation is nothing but a simple technique of reducing the human effort and improve the performance simultaneously. So to automate tasks, we obviously need tools, right? So one such tool is UiPath. So apart from that, let me also tell you that, you know, robotic process automation offers various kinds of tools such as Blue Prism, Automation Anywhere, NICE, Pega, Antworks, and so on. But the top market leaders are basically UiPath, Blue Prism, and Automation Anywhere. Since this session is basically on UiPath, let's just focus on what exactly UiPath is. So UiPath, as I said before, is a robotic process automation tool which offers desktop automation with the help of drag and drop functionalities. So what happens with UiPath is that it's just really simple to use, as, you know, every activity or every action that you want to perform, it offers activities to do so. So for example, if you just want to iterate the same action, like, you know, 100 times, you don't have to write a for loop for it. Instead, you can just use the for each activity, and then you can make sure that, you know, your action is iterated 100 times, right? Apart from that, let me also tell you that, you know, this tool comes with a community edition, which is free for a lifetime. And if you're new to automation, guys, start using UiPath and start learning how to automate tasks using UiPath. So with the note of this, let me get to the main topic for today's session, that is UiPath automation examples. So basically, what we'll be doing in this session is that we'll be looking into five different kinds of automation, where I'll show you how you can, you know, move the files from the source folder to the destination folder. In the web automation part, we'll be seeing how we can scrape the data from a website and store it in a CSV file. In the email automation part, what we'll see is that, you know, we'll make sure that, you know, our top 30 emails are read. And then from all those 30 emails, what will be done is that the attachments of all those 30 emails, which will have a specific keyword, would be saved, right? So that's what we're going to do for email automation. For Excel automation, what we're going to do is we're going to have a CSV file with a list of details. And then what we're going to do is we're going to automate the task of filling the Google form automatically from the data stored in the CSV file. And finally, coming to the PDF automation, in the PDF automation, we'll simply see how the text can be extracted from the PDF documents, right? So I hope I'm clear with what we're going to do with this session. All right, so now let's move on with the first automation for today, that is moving files from the folders, right? So if you ask me, what is our task is to mainly move all the files from the source folder to the destination folder, right? So basically, you can have n number of files in your source folder, right? Like, suppose, just imagine you have around 20 files in your source folder. Now you don't want to copy paste each and every file to the destination folder, right? So what you can simply do is you can just automate this task of, you know, whatever file is being stored in a specific folder will be automatically moved into the destination folder, right? Now, if you just ask me, where is it used in industries, you can just see that, you know, if you're running an enterprise, you may get few files from the server, and those files could be stored in a specific folder, right? Now, those files could be required by a lot of company users, right? A lot of employees, right? So what we can simply do is, so instead of just an employee, you know, requesting for every file to be copied to his particular folder, what we can simply do is we can just automate this task of, you know, whenever a particular file or, you know, whenever a number of files come to a specific folder from our server, these files can be automatically transferred to the destination folder, right? So from this destination folder, all these employees can then specifically take whatever files they want, right? So this is how this is basically used in an industry. But over here, let me just give you a simple example, like how you can just move your files from the source folder to the destination folder on your desktop, right? So before I switch back to my UiPath, let me just tell you the process workflow for this particular automation. So what we're going to first do is that, you know, we're going to first assign the source directory to a variable. Then we're going to count the number of files to be moved by using a counter variable. And then we'll make sure that, you know, those number of files to be moved are displayed in a message box. After that, what we'll do is we'll mention the destination path in the move file activity. And then we'll finally, what we'll do is for each item in the source path, we'll use the counter variable to move the file to the destination path, right? So I hope I'm clear. So let's just go through it once again. We're going to assign the source directory to a variable first, and then we're going to initialize a counter variable, which will count the number of files to be moved. And then what we'll do is we'll mention the destination path in the move file activity. And finally, for each item in the source path, we'll use the counter variable to move the files to the mentioned destination path, right? So I hope I'm clear. All right. So now let me just quickly shift back to my UiPath Studio so that we get started with the automation, right? So let me just shift back. All right. So what I'll do is I'll create a new project. So let me just click on process. So let's just name the process to be automation demo. Right. So once I'm done with that, I'll just click on create. Once you click on create, you'll see that, you know, you'll be redirected to your UiPath dashboard where you can start automating your tasks. So let's just wait for that. All right. So guys, this is how your dashboard looks like. It has basically the right menu, which consists of properties pane. The left side is all the activities. At the bottom, we have the output pane. So I hope I'm clear. So let's just start by just automating the task directly. So for that, what I'll do is, first of all, I'll just drag a flowchart. So I'm dragging a flowchart because I'm just creating a single file for all the automations that I'm going to create. So I'll just use this flowchart to directly point which sequence has to run, right? So for that, what I'll do is now I'll just create a sequence to start with the first automation. So in this particular sequence, I'm going to mention all the details or all the activities that we have to consider for moving files from one folder to the other, right? So I'll just rename the sequence first. Let's say move files from source to destination, right? So after that, what you can do is you can just double click here and then you can start with this particular automation. So the first step, what you have to do is you have to create variables. To create variables, you can just click over here and then you'll see an option to create variables, right? So I'll just create the variables for number of files, source path, and the counter variable. So I'll just mention number of files. And then I want it to be of type array of t where it has to be of string type, right? And then I'll create another variable that is the counter variable. So this will basically count the number of files that have to be moved, right? So let it to be of int type. And then I'll create a source path variable, right? So let the source path variable to be of string type, right? So now that your variables are created, what we'll simply do is we'll first drag the assign activity. So for that, what I'll do is I'll drag the assign activity from here. And then in this particular activity, what you have to do is in the to section, you have to mention number of files variable. And in the enter a variable section, what you have to mention is basically directory.getFiles. And then you'll mention source path. Right, so that's basically our variable for source path. So what's basically happening over here is that we have mentioned a function which will get all the files from the source path and then it will store that particular value in the number of files variable, right? So that's what we have done in this particular activity. Now what you have to do is, now what we want is once we get all the files from the source path, we want a message box which displays that, you know, so many files have been found, right? So to do that, what we'll do is we'll just search for message box. And then I'll drag and drop over here. Over here, what I'll do is I'll just mention number of files dot count. So this will basically count my number of files to string. And then what I'll do is I'll put a plus symbol. So this will basically concatenate with the text that I also want to print. So the text that I want to print is basically so many files to be moved, right? So files to be moved, right? So what's basically happening over here is that, you know, so many files. So basically, if we say like, you know, 20 files are present in the source path, then in the message box, we'll see an output that, you know, 20 files to be moved, right? So that's how we can do. Now, after this, what you have to do is you have to assign the counter variable to zero. To do that, what you'll simply do is you'll again go to the assign activity. You'll search for that. You'll search for the assigned activity, you'll mention counter, and then you'll mention value to be 0, right? So basically you've initialized the counter variable to be 0. Now what you have to do is, for each file in the source path, you have to move that particular file to the destination path, right? So for that, you'll drag the for each activity first. So for that, let's just search for each activity. And then what you have to do is, you have to mention the number of files over here. So what's basically happening is, for each item in number of files, that is for each file in the source path, you want few actions to be occurred, right? So mainly those actions are basically to move the file to the destination path. So to do that, you'll just search for the move file activity. And then what you'll do is, in this move file activity, you'll mention the destination path, right? So I'll just search for the destination path. So I'll just copy this, and then in double quotes, I'll just mention it over here. One thing I forgot to mention is basically the source path. So basically over here in the source path, I'm going to mention this. So I'll just click over here, and then in the value section, I'm going to mention the source path also. So this is basically my source path. I'll copy this, and in double quotes, I'll mention over here, right? So we have mentioned the destination path and the source path also. Now, if you just execute this automation, what you would see is that, you know, this automation would run for only one file, right? Now, since our source path can have n number of files, to continuously iterate this particular action, what you simply have to do is, you again have to assign the counter variable to counter plus 1, right? So I'll just search for assign activity, and then I'll mention counter equal to counter plus 1, right? So now what will happen is, this automation will work for n number of files that are present in the source path, right? Okay. So as you can see, we have around 100 files in our source path. So now what I'll do is, I just want this 100 files to be moved to the destination path, right? So I'll just execute this particular automation. So before that, what I'll do is, I'll just go to this flowchart option and then point the arrow. So I'll just point this arrow to this particular sequence. That means that, you know, this particular sequence has to run first, right? All right. So we see that, you know, there are a few errors in this particular sequence. Let's see what are the errors. All right. So before I execute this particular automation, what else you have to do is, in the for each activity, you have to change the type argument to be string. And then in the move file activity, you have to mention the path to be item, right? So basically what's happening over here is, since our number of files is of a string type, we have to make sure that, you know, our type argument is string. And in the move file activity, we have to make sure that, you know, the from path is mentioned. That is basically for each item in the source path, right? So that's the reason we've mentioned item over here. Now, once that is done, what you can simply do is, you can just click on this debug option. So I'll just click on this debug option. And then you can see that, you know, your automation is getting executed, right? So you can clearly see that, you know, 100 files have to be moved. So once you click on OK, you can see on the right hand side that your execution is getting executed, right? So that means all the files from the source path are getting transferred to the destination path. So let's just wait for that to happen, and we'll see that, you know, our automation has executed, right? So let's just wait. So you can see that, you know, our automation has got executed, right? So now what we can do is, let's just switch back to our source folder. So in the source folder, you can see that, you know, this folder is empty. Initially it had 100 files. Now let's go to the destination folder. In the destination folder, you can clearly see that, you know, we've put around 100 files. So that means, you know, you've transferred all the files from the source folder to the destination folder, right? So guys, that's how you can automate this particular task. What you simply had to do is, you had to just use the assign activity, mention the variable, that is basically the source path variable, then mention a message box to show you the output of, you know, how many files have to be moved. Then you just had to initialize the counter variable to the assign activity. And then for each item in the number of files present in the source activity, you just had to use the move file activity to move to the specified destination folder that would be specified in this particular activity, right? After that, what you had to do is, you had to just put counter equal to counter plus 1. That is basically, you had to just assign counter plus 1 to counter, so that, you know, this particular action is iterated for the number of files that are present in the source path, right? So guys, that's how you can just automate this particular simple task. Now let's move to the next automation, that is basically our web automation. So the main task of web automation is that, you know, we want to scrape the data from the website and then store it in a CSV file. So when you say scrape the data from a website and store it in a CSV file, if you just wonder, you know, why are we doing this and how is it used in industries? Well, let me tell you that, you know, it may happen that, you know, your enterprise have a lot of competitors, right? They could just want to scrape the data of their competitors and store and then analyze that particular data and make sure how they can benefit from it, right? Similarly, we can also see that, you know, mostly the shopping website can scrape each other's data because all of them sell the same products, right? So they could see that, you know, what are the prices that the other enterprises are offering for the same product and how, you know, they can make sure that their users are stuck to that particular website and they do not go to any other e-commerce websites, right? So there are various use cases of where people use web automation. But for our instance, I'm just going to scrape the data from a single website and then I'm going to show you how to store it in a CSV file, right? So let's just get started. So before that, let me just take you through the process workflow. The process workflow is really simple. You just have to open your UiPath Studio, and then what you have to do is you have to use the data scraping tool and record the data that you want to extract from. So basically, first you have to make sure that your website is open, and then you go back to the UiPath Studio and then choose the data scraping tool. Once you choose that, you just indicate the elements of what all data you want to choose, and then you choose the right CSV activity to store all the data that has been extracted from the website, right? So that's really simple, guys. So let me just shift back to my UiPath Studio and show you how that's done. So what I'll do is I'll go back to flowchart. I'll add a new sequence. So I'll just search for sequence over here. And now what I'll do is I'll just name this particular sequence. So let me just name it to be web automation, right? And then what I'll do is I'll just, you know, put this particular arrow over here. So I'll just make sure then this particular sequence runs now, right? So we can see that, you know, this particular sequence will run. So I'll just open this particular sequence. So what I've done is I've already made sure my website is open. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to extract all this particular data and then I'm going to store it in a CSV file. So to do so, what I'll do is I'll go back to my UiPath Studio. I'll go to the design tab and then I'll choose data scraping. Now what I'll do is in this particular dialog box that opens up, I'll just click on next and then I'll choose which particular field has to be extracted. Since I want the name to be extracted, I'll just click on this. And then what I'll do is I have to choose the second element with a similar field, right? So by this, what I mean is that, you know, if I've chosen the name of the bag, then the second element also has to be the name of the bag to create a pattern. So with that, what automation tool will understand is that, you know, all the names have to get extracted, right? So what I'll do is I'll just mention the column name to be name. And then let's see, you know, we check in this box for extracting URL also. So I'll just mention this column name to be URL also, and then I'll click on next. So once you click on next, you'll see that, you know, this is the preview data. That is basically the name column has names of all the bags and the URL column has all the URLs of that particular bags, right? Now, apart from this, if you just want also the correlated data, by which I mean that, you know, if you just want the price and what was the price before that, what we can simply do is we'll just go to this option of extract correlated data. I'll choose this option of ₹3749. And that will choose the price, right? Now, similarly, I'll choose the second element. So for that, I'll click on next. I'll indicate this particular element, right? So over here, what I'll simply do is I'll again rename the column to be price, or let's say present price, right? And then I'll click on next. So once I click on next, you can see that, you know, the name, the URL and the present price has been extracted, right? Now, apart from this, if you just want, you know, the past price also, you can again indicate that particular element and then you can move forward. Right now, what I want you to concentrate on is basically that, you know, if you want to extract the data from multiple pages, then how do we do that? So to do that, what you'll simply do is you'll click on finish. And then once you click on finish, you'll get a dialog box which clearly says is data spanning multiple pages. That is basically if you want to extract data from multiple pages, so you would obviously want to do that, right? So to do that, you'll just click on yes, and then you'll indicate the element. So this is basically the element which goes to the next page, right? So I'll just click on this. And then once I click on that, you'll clearly see that, you know, you'll be redirected to your UiPath Studio, right? Now what you can simply do is you can just copy this and put it inside this particular sequence. So I'll just do that. I'll delete this over here. And now what I want to do is I want to write the extracted data to a CSV file, right? So for that, I'll search the right CSV activity. And then I'll drag and drop over here in the do section of this particular activity. Now, what we have to do is we have to mention the output variable. So the output variable is basically the data table variable that is automatically created by the data scraping wizard. So if you go to this option of extract structured data, you'll see in the output section that, you know, extract data table is present. So you just copy this particular variable, paste it over here, right? And in this particular section, you have to mention the file path. So I'll just mention the file path. So let's say I mentioned the file path to be data CSV, right? So you can see that, you know, our data would be written into this particular file path, right? So what I'll simply do is I'll just execute this particular automation. So let me just first execute this particular automation. To do that, I'll just go to execute tab and click on debug. Now, once you click on debug, you can clearly see that your data is getting extracted from the web pages. So if you clearly see, your website is getting loaded again and again. That means your data is getting spanned for multiple pages. All right. So now once the execution is done, you can clearly see that the name, the URL and the present price that we extracted got saved in our CSV file, right? So guys, this was just a sample demo on how you can extract data from websites and store it in your CSV file. Well, you can also play a lot around with the selectors, and you can extract only specific elements, and then you can use web automation. So for that, you can refer to our selectors video. So don't worry, I'll just leave the video link in the description box so that you can go through it, right? So guys, that was all about web automation. So what I had simply done for web automation is that, you know, I just made sure that my website is open, and then I use the data scraping tool to scrape the required data. So I just indicated those elements which are required, and then finally I just used the right CSV activity, right? So that's how you can do. Now let's move forward to the next automation, that is basically our email automation. So our main task in email automation is basically to save the attachments of the top 30 emails which have a keyword in the subject line, right? So I hope I'm clear. What I'm simply trying to do is I'm going to save the attachments of the top 30 emails which have a keyword in the subject line, right? So that's how I'm going to do. Now to do that, before I go to the UiPath Studio, let me just tell you the process workflow. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to assign the email address to a variable, and then I'll mention the password in the get password activity. After that, for each email, we have to mention the keyword that we want to consider in the subject line, and then we'll use an if-else loop. So in the if-else loop, what we're going to simply do is, in the if section, we're going to basically use the save attachments activity, where we're going to mention the destination directory. So basically, that's the directory where our attachments would be saved, right? So I hope I'm clear. Don't worry, I'm going to show you how that's going to be done. So let me just quickly shift back to my UiPath Studio. Right, so now what I'll do is I'll just create a new sequence again. Right, so I'm just going to rename this sequence email automation. So let me just type that, and then I'll double click over here. Now the first step is to create variables for email, password and the get mail messages. So what I'll do is I'll just double click here. I'll type in email and let it to be of string type. Similarly, I'll type in password and let it to be of string type again. Create another variable, that is get mail messages, and then over here it has to be of list type, and over here we'll search for mail message, right? So basically these are the three variables that you have to create, that is the email, password and the get mail messages, right? So now what you have to do is you have to first drag an assign activity. So I'll just drag and drop an assign activity. And then what I'll do is in the to section of the assign activity, I'll mention the email variable. And then over here, I'll mention my email address, right? So let me just mention my email address, right? Now, once I'm done mentioning my email address, I have to mention my password also, right? So I'll just search for get password. I'll drag and drop this activity over here. I've mentioned my password. And in the results section, what I'll do is I'll mention the password variable. Right, so that's what we have to do. That is basically we have to mention the password for our email ID over here, and in the results section we have to mention the password variable. Now what we have to do is we have to drag and drop the get IMAP mail message activity. So I'll search for get IMAP and then I'll drag and drop this activity. Now over here what you have to do is you have to mention which folder, the port number, the server and so on, right? So we'll start with the folders. Basically the folder would stand the same, that is basically from the inbox. The port number would be 993. The server would be imap.gmail.com. Right? The email variable would be the email variable. And the password variable will be the password variable. And then what I'll do is I'll again mention the top 30. So since I want the top 30 emails to be read, so I'll mention top 30 over here. And then in the messages option, I'll mention get mail messages variable. Right? So what I've done is I've mentioned the mail folder, that is basically the inbox, the port number to be 993, the server to be imap.gmail.com, the email and password to be our email and password variables. The top 30 mails would be mentioned over here, and in the messages section, I'll mention the get mail messages variable. Right? Now what we want to do is for each mail, you know, having a particular keyword in the subject line, our attachments have to be saved, right? So for that, first of all, I'll drag the for each activity. And then what I'll do is, for each mail in the get mail messages, what I'll do is I'll mention an if loop. That is basically an if activity where, you know, if the condition satisfies, that is basically if our subject line has a specific keyword, then the attachments would be saved, else nothing would happen, right? So for that, what I'll do is I'll search for if activity. I'll drag and drop in the body section. And then what I'll do is I'll mention the condition over here. So the condition is basically that our subject line basically contains a keyword. So for that, what I'll do is I'll just type in mail.subject.contains, and then I'll mention the keyword. So let's say, you know, we mention our keyword to be exam, right? So all the attachments from those mails which have a subject line, and then that particular subject line will have the keyword example, would be saved in the destination path, right? So what I'll do is I'll just drag and drop the save attachments activity now, and then I'll mention the mail variable over here. And in this particular section, I'll mention the destination path. So I want all the files to be saved in this particular folder. So I'll just mention sample output over here. What I've done is basically I've assigned the email address, and then I've mentioned the get password activity. Then in the IMAP mail messages activity, I've configured all the required configurations. And then for each mail, what we want to do is, for every subject, it has to check whether, you know, the subject has the keyword example or not. If it has the keyword example, it's going to save the attachments from that particular mail to this particular destination folder, right? So I hope I'm clear. So let me just open my email ID and let me just show you the top 30 mails. So as you can see on my screen, I have few mails. I've received few mails, you know, which have the subject line example, and then also some other mails which do not have the subject line example, right? So let's just execute our automation and see, you know, if all the attachments get saved or not. So for that, what I'll do is I'll just go back to this UiPath Studio, then I'll click on the debug option. So you can see that, you know, our execution is getting executed. So once the execution gets executed, let me just shift back to my sample output, and you can see that, you know, all the attachments from the mail which had the subject line example, that is basically a keyword example, got saved in this particular folder, right? So guys, that's how you can use this particular automation. So basically what I've done over here is that I just created three variables, that is email, password, and get mail messages. Now after that, I just used the assign activity to just assign the email address to the variable. Then I had used the get password activity to mention the password, and the get IMAP mail messages to configure the folder, port number, server, the DOP messages, and how many mails have to be read and so on. And after that, we mentioned the for each activity. So in the for each activity, what I've done is for every mail, the subject line would be read. And if the condition satisfied, the attachments from that particular mail would be stored in the specified mentioned folder, right? So I hope I'm clear with this particular point. So guys, that's how you can automate this. So that was all about email automation, guys. Now let's move forward to the next automation, that is basically the Excel automation. So what we're going to do in Excel automation is basically that we're going to fill a Google form automatically from the data stored in a CSV file, right? So I'm going to show you what the Google form is, and then I'm going to show you the CSV file and how we're going to collaborate both of these to make sure that, you know, all the data that's stored in our CSV file gets stored in the application form, right? So let's just start with that. So before I start with that, let me just take you through the workflow of this particular automation. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to first create a Google form and mention all the details that I want to fill in. So I've already done that part. My Google form is ready. If you just want to create a Google form, then you just type in Google form in Google, and then you'll be redirected to how to create a Google form. After that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a CSV file and mention all the details. So that part is also ready, guys. My CSV file is ready. Now, what I'm going to do is in the UiPath Studio, I'm going to use the open browser activity, and then I'm going to mention the Google Forms URL. After that, I'm going to use the for each row activity. And then what I'm going to do is for each row in the Excel table, I'm going to configure how to fill in the details. So basically, I'm going to indicate the elements on the Google form, right? So you'll see how that's happening. Let me just show you my CSV file and the Google form, right? So let me just show you that part. So guys, this is my Google form that I created. So basically, I've created a Google form for a job application form. So basically, I want the full name, the phone number, the past experience in years, the educational qualification, skill set, and the position for all the people applying for the job, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to just open my CSV file and show you the details that I mentioned. So let me just open the CSV file and show you. All right, guys. So as you can see, this is my CSV file where I've mentioned the full name, phone number, past experience, educational qualification, skill set, and position for 5 applicants, right? So now what we're going to do is we're going to make sure that, you know, all these details are filled automatically in the Google form, right? So to do that, what you have to first do is we'll go back to the flowchart, and then what I'll do is I'll drag a sequence, and let's say, you know, I drag that sequence to be the read CSV activity, right? So first step it is to make sure that, you know, our CSV has been read. So I'll just mention this name of the sequence to be read CSV, and then what I'll do is I'll drag and drop the read CSV activity. After that, I'll just mention the path of this particular file, that is basically sample, right? Now what you have to do is you have to again drag another sequence. So I'll just drag another sequence, and then what I'll do is I'll just rename it to be Google Form Actions. And now what I'll do is I'll double click this particular sequence, and then what I'll do is I'll drag and drop the open browser activity, right? So basically with this activity, we are making sure that, you know, our browser is open. Now over here, we have to mention the URL for our Google form. So I'll just copy from here, put in double quotes. And then what I'll do is in the do section of this particular activity, we have to make sure that, you know, for each row in the CSV file, our data has to be filled in the Google form, right? So for that, we'll type in for each row activity. So we'll drag and drop it over here. And then we'll make sure we create a variable of data table, right? Now what you have to do is you have to go back to the flowchart, and then in the read CSV activity, you have to create a variable that is basically a data table variable, right? So for that, what you'll do is you'll just type in data table, and in the browse types also, you'll just search for data table type. Right, and in the scope, you'll make sure that, you know, it's for the complete flowchart so that, you know, the other sequence can also access this particular variable. Now we'll come back over here, we'll come back to a sequence of Google Forms, and in this particular activity of for each row, we'll mention that particular variable, that is data table, right? Now after that, what you have to do is you have to make sure that, you know, for each value, that is, for example, you know, John has to be filled in the full name section, right? So to make sure, what you'll do is you'll just use the type into activity. You'll just drag and drop it over here. And then what you'll do is you'll indicate the element inside the browser, right? So what I'll do is I'll just click over here, and then I'll make sure that, you know, I'll click it over here. That means that, you know, it's clear for our automation that, you know, the full name that has been extracted from our CSV file must be filled over here. That is basically in this particular section, right? So I'll just click over here. Now, similarly, what I'll do is I'll mention for the other fields, that is phone number, past experience, qualification, skill set, and position, right? So I'll just drag and drop quite number of type into activities. And then let's indicate them one by one. So we'll indicate phone number. And then I'll indicate the past experience in years. Then I'll indicate the educational qualifications. Then I'll indicate the skill set. And then I'll indicate the position. Right? So basically what we've done is we've indicated all the elements for a full name, phone number, past experience, and so on. Now what we have to make sure is that, you know, for each row, that is basically for each row in our CSV file. So when I say for each row, I mean that, you know, for example, if we consider the first row, that is the full name. So for every full name, the data has to be filled in the full name area only, right? So to mention that, what you'll do is you'll mention over here, that is row, and then you'll mention the row name. So I'll just copy this. And then in double quotes over here, you'll mention this and convert it to string, right? So basically what I've done is I've mentioned the row name, and then I've made sure that any particular value that is extracted from that particular row would be filled in this particular area of the Google form, right? Now, similarly, I'm going to repeat this step for phone number. So I'll just copy phone number text from here. I'll again type in row. I'll mention phone number to string, right? Similarly, we're going to do it for past experience in years. So I'm going to copy the text. I'll mention row. I'll mention past experience in years and to string. Now, similarly, let's do it for educational qualifications. So I'll just copy the text from here. I've mentioned row in double quotations. I'll mention educational qualifications to string. Right? Now, next, let's do the same thing for skill set. So I'll copy this, I'll mention row to string, right? And similarly, what I'll do is I'll mention row and then I'll copy the text for position in double quotations. I'll mention row, position, and convert it to string. Right? So what I've done is I've made sure that, you know, my CSV file has been read. After that, I've just used an open browser activity to make sure that, you know, our Google form is being opened. And then I've used the for each row activity. In the for each row activity, I've used the same variable as the output variable of read CSV. And then I've used the type into activities to indicate the element on the screen. That is basically where the data has to be filled in our Google Forms. And what data has been mentioned by using this row full name to string, row phone number to string, and so on, right? So now what you have to do is, once you fill in all the details, what you simply have to do is you have to make sure that, you know, you submit the Google form, right? So to submit the Google form, if you open your Google form, you'll clearly see that, you know, you have a submit button. So to do that, what you'll do is you'll just search for the click activity. You'll drag and drop it over here and then you'll indicate the element. So this is basically what we indicate. We indicate the submit button. So that's how you indicate. Now, after that, what you have to do is you have to consider the delay, right? It may happen sometimes that, you know, the page may take a little while to load, right? So for that, we'll just drag and drop the delay activity. And then we'll mention 3 seconds, right? And after that, what you also have to make sure that, you know, you want n number of entries to be entered, right? So this particular automation at present would work for only one single entry. That is basically one single row. Now, if you want to enter the details for any number of rows that are present in a CSV file, you have to make sure that, you know, once your Google form has been submitted, it has to go back also, right? So to do that, you'll just search for the go back activity and then you'll drag and drop it over here. So guys, that's what I've done. What I've done is I've just created a sequence where I've mentioned an open browser activity, and in that I've mentioned the URL. And then what I've done is in the for each row activity, that is basically in the do section of the open browser activity, I've used the for each row activity. And then I've mentioned the variable that was used in a read CSV activity. After that, what I've done is I've made sure that, you know, for each row, the value present in the cell has to be mentioned in the respective area. So basically, I've indicated on screen where the full name has to be filled, where the phone number has to be filled, and so on. And after that, once you fill in all the details, I've made sure that it clicks on the submit button. So to click on that, I've just used the click activity, and then I've also considered the delay activity to consider the page load time. And also finally the go back activity to make sure that, you know, any number of entries that are present in the CSV file gets filled, right? So now let's just quickly debug this. So before I debug this in the flowchart, let me show you that, you know, I've mentioned the starting point to be read CSV activity. And from there, I've connected the second sequence, that is the Google Form sequence. So basically what would happen is first our CSV file would be read, all the data would be extracted and stored in the output variable, that is the data table. And after that, it will be filled in the Google form, right? So I hope I'm clear with this point. Now let me just quickly click on the debug option to start executing this particular sequence. All right, so you can see that, you know, the data is getting filled again and again, and then you'll see that a response will be submitted. Again, the Google form would load by itself and the data will be filled, right? So that's how, guys, you can automate how to fill data in the Google Forms, right? So I hope I'm clear how we can automate. Let's just this automation continue. What I've simply done in this automation is that I just simply use the read CSV activity to read the CSV activity. And then what I've done is I just connected the Google Forms. After that, what I've done is I just created another sequence. And in that sequence, I made sure that, you know, I use the open browser activity to open the browser and then finally mention the Google Form URL. And over there in the for each row activity, in the do section of the open browser activity, what I'd done is I'd used the type into activity to make sure that, you know, all the details present in the CSV file get stored in the Google form, right? Once that is done, I just also mentioned the click activity to click on the submit button. And finally, the delay and the go back activity to keep going back, right? So I hope I'm clear with this point, right? So guys, that was all about the Excel automation. So now let's move on to the final automation, that is basically our PDF automation, right? So in the PDF automation, what we're going to do is we can either extract only text or we can either extract a text with images, right? So we can extract both of them. What I'm going to do is I'm going to consider a sample PDF and then I'm going to show you how we can extract the data and then how we can store it in a message box or how you can store it in a CSV file or a text file, right? So for that, let me just open my sample document. So guys, this is my sample document from which I want to extract text, or, you know, I also want to extract text with images. So basically, if you see, this is an image and this is text. So what I'm going to first do is how to extract only text, and then what we're going to say is how to extract the text in the images also. So to do that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back to my UiPath studio, right? And then I'm going to drag a sequence. And in this particular sequence, let's say, you know, we mention it to be read PDF text. And then what I'll do is I'll just double click on the sequence. And what I'll do is I'll just search for the read PDF activity. All right. So if you see that, you know, you don't find any read PDF activity, you first have to install the package. So for that, you'll go to manage packages option and you'll search for UiPath PDF. So I'll just install this. I'll click on save. Right. So now if I search for read PDF, you'll clearly see the options. So I'll just click on the sequence and then I'll drag and drop this particular activity in this particular sequence. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to just mention the path of the PDF over here. So that's on my desktop and it's hands-on. So I'll just mention the path. And then let's say, you know, we want the output in a message box. So I'll just search for a message box. And then let's say, you know, I mentioned the output variable to be output. I'll just mention the output variable over here. And then what you can simply do is we can just execute this particular sequence. So now before I just execute this particular sequence, let me put the start node of the flowchart to this particular sequence and let me just remove the connection. And now I'll just click on debug. So once I click on debug, you can see that, you know, the complete PDF which had all the text got extracted. So if you see, we completely had text and just one image with the text. So if we just search for this line, you know, where it says scuba diving, which must have come in the start itself, you would see that, you know, this particular image was ignored, right? So basically that's all you could do. So since this is causing a lot of confusion, what I'll simply do for you is I'll mention the range to be 1. So that means that, you know, only the first page would be read. So again, let's just debug this. So that means it's getting executed. And you'll see that, you know, I vacationed in the Caribbean where I did scuba diving. So that means this particular image text was completely ignored, right? So that's how, guys, you can extract the text from the PDF. Now, similarly, if you want to extract the text from the images also, what you can simply do is I'll just drag and drop a new sequence and then I'll just rename it to read PDF text images. And then if I just click on this, what I'll do is I'll just drag and drop the read PDF with OCR activity. So what will happen over here is the text from the images would be also read from this particular activity. So to do that, you'll again mention the path of the folder. Now after that, what you have to do is you have to drag and drop an OCR engine, right? So if you just search for OCR, you'll see that, you know, you'll get a list of OCR engines that has been installed or, you know, configured for your UiPath Studio. So I'm going to use the Google OCR. So I'll just drag and drop the Google OCR over here. In the properties pane, you can also configure the other properties like, you know, language, profile, scale, and so on. Now in the read PDF with OCR activity, just create a variable that is the output variable. So I'll just mention output over here by pressing on Control K, and then I'll drag and drop a message box. And over here, I'll mention the output variable. So I hope I'm clear with this point. So I'll just put the start node of the flowchart to this particular sequence and then I'll click on debug. So you can see that, you know, the complete text and the text from the images has been extracted. So since it's not clear for you in this particular message box, let me just go back to this particular sequence. And then over here, I'll just configure for one page, right? And then I'll debug again. So you can clearly see that, you know, after scuba diving, the text that was present in the image, that is basically the part to success is to take massive determined action, has been also extracted, right? So guys, that's how you can, you know, automate tasks on PDF. Guys, this was a short demo on PDF, guys. So if you want a detailed explanation of how you can extract specific elements also in PDF, you can refer to our PDF data extraction video. I'll leave the video link in the description box below, right? So guys, that's an end to today's session. I hope you found this session informative. Please remember that, you know, before you start automating tasks, you have to install packages or, you know, you have to manage packages from this manage packages option. And then you have to make sure that, you know, you download and install all the required packages. For example, like, you know, for Excel automation, we need the Excel activities. For the mail automation, we need the mail activities. For the PDF automation, we need the PDF activities and so on, right? So make sure that, you know, you've installed all the packages and then you're ready to go, right? So guys, that's all for today's session from my side. I hope you found this session informative. Thank you and have a great day.
I hope you have enjoyed listening to this video. Please be kind enough to like it, and you can comment any of your doubts and queries, and we will reply them at the earliest. Do look out for more videos in our playlist and subscribe to Edureka channel to learn more. Happy learning!